guys, what's up? This is Matt from Flick Fanatics. It's 2015. I'm here with John.
Hey, what's up, guys? Can't wait for that new BVS movie coming out next March.
We got Jordan here too.
It's really good. Really good.
He sees into the future with a crystal ball. Yeah. And then we got Tim here, who's living in ultraviolet era.
Yep. Can't wait for that to hit theaters. I did see that in theaters, by the way. What's up, guys?
Hey, that's pretty awesome. But hey, we're all here. We're here to discuss some movies that we've watched lately since the last time we did one of these, which was like a month ago. So we wanted to start off with any films that you've seen that you didn't see last time that we had this conversation.
I've seen Fences and definitely a movie that is performance based. I think I would definitely like switch out that for Patriots Day. And if somebody were able to say, hey, you could take out you could flip a Best Picture nomination and I would take Fences out and put Patriots Day in. Denzel was so good in that though. So was Viola Davis. Oh my God. Yeah. But like the overall movie, I didn't see the play or read anything about it. So like the movie was really like in just three different areas and you feel the runtime. My God, it's over 2 hours and you feel it.
Yeah. But
overall, it's great performances. And I saw Split. Nice. It's not an Oscar movie, but I saw Split like twice.
Oh, we'll get into Split.
Okay. Nice.
Okay. We'll get into Split. Tim or John, did you see Fences?
Yeah.
No, that's actually one of the last ones. Go ahead.
No. Yeah. Well, Matt was like, Matt was like, Tim and John, did you see it? I did see it.
Did you like it?
Yeah. Like, I'm going to just echo what Jordan says. Like, dude, the performances were great in that movie. It does feel a little like long in the tooth, especially in that last act. But it plays like a play. It was really good. It was still a good movie.
Good movie.
Yeah, it was good.
Nice, mm-hmm. Cool. And Tim, you said you haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, that's one of the few ones I haven't seen. I think I'm gonna wait. I'm not gonna try to catch it in theaters. I think I'm gonna wait till it comes out. I really want to see it though. It looks really, really good. It's based on a play too.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I'm in the same boat. I haven't seen it, but I would like to eventually.
It's one of those movies like you don't really need to see in the theater. I went and I think I was like the only other, like there's like me and one person in that theater. So it was like pretty, you know, it's a quiet movie. It's very performance based. So, you know, it's cool to see it on the big screen, but it's not like, you know, you're seeing the next, you know, like blockbuster or like horror movie that has really cool sound design that you would miss at home.
So, yeah. John, you see anything else in the Oscar contenders and all that?
After we talked all about those movies, I was like writing a list down after we all talked. I'm just gonna go through them. I saw a bunch of movies. I saw La La Land and I freaking loved it. I saw Lion. Oh, what's up? Sorry.
Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to. How was that? I want to see.
Oh, mine was actually really good. Like, I got my Letterbox list up here. I actually it cracked my top five. I liked it a lot, actually. It's my number five. I saw Sing Street, which I loved. That's my number seven of the year. I saw Moana. I saw Fences. I saw The Founder. I saw Gold. Yeah, I think that's the new ones that I saw.
Right? Didn't you see Silence?
Oh, yeah, but I didn't know if I saw that before or after the podcast.
I forget. Yeah,
I saw Silence, and I saw Moonlight, and and then I saw Split.
Damn, you guys have seen everything.
Yeah, dude. Well, and then I saw, you know, Resident Evil, the final chapter. And then I saw, we can talk about that later if you guys want.
I'm sure we will.
I'm done.
And then I also saw, and then, yeah, other 2017 films I saw. I saw John Wick Chapter 2. And tomorrow I'm going to see Get Out. And, over the weekend I'm going to go see Lego Batman, too.
I saw Lego Batman, too.
Nice.
We're going to talk about that one later.
Cool.
For sure.
All right. So, yeah, those are the movies I saw.
Nice. Tim, how about you? What have you seen?
I think, well, in terms of 2016 movies, I saw Masterminds finally after waiting 2 full years.
Oh, man. How was it?
I thought it was kind of funny. It's pretty low on my list. I would never see it again, but I had a fun time. I like dumb comedies. I love Zach Galifianakis. But in terms of good movies, actually, I saw Swiss Army Man finally.
Oh, cool.
I haven't seen that one yet.
I have to admit, I don't know if I loved it. It's pretty low on my list. It's right below X-Men Apocalypse.
Uh-oh.
But I know some people loved it, and I think it's just it's kind of like the Neon Demon for me. It's like, I just didn't like it, but I can see why everyone loves it. And then it actually cracked my top 10. The last movie I saw that I didn't get to see yet was Deepwater Horizon.
Oh,
brilliant. Nice. Brilliant, brilliant. There are some scenes in that movie that gave me chills, and there are some scenes where I was like, you know, that one guy in the theater who claps, like I was that guy all alone in my room.
Nice.
Nice, dude. That
That's
was like
cool, though. That looked pictures there. That looked good. I've heard a lot of good things about that one.
It was very unexpectedly good. I thought it was going to be like, you know, like American Sniper, and I haven't seen Lone Survivor, so I don't really know what this guy's film's like, but I was afraid it was going to be like an overly political, you know, more of like, this is what's wrong about the world and like BP, but like, it actually was more about the people,
yeah,
which is really important. Just like
that's cool.
Secret Soldiers of Benghazi.
Yeah, that's a good movie too.
Underrated movie. I will be the first to admit that. That is actually a pretty solid war film.
But, yeah, it never really bashed anyone. It was just about the soldiers.
Yeah.
Right. Which leads me to some of my recent watches with the 2016 movies. I caught up with what did I see? I saw The Shallows. Which I heard a lot of hype earlier in the year. Well, wasn't really my thing, I'm gonna be honest with you. I didn't really dig it that much. I could see why people like it though. I can get it. The style has an interesting style. The editing, I like the text on screen with like the motion graphics when she's talking to people. I think all that's like clever. As far as the story goes, though, I wasn't too interested. That's
looks
just
good too.
You know, it is a good looking movie for sure.
Really cool.
I also saw Lights Out, which kind of the same thing. I was like, it was okay. It wasn't anything special in the horror genre for me. It was the ending was kind of silly, but. And then I saw Sing Street, which top five or three, man. That was an awesome movie. I freaking loved it. And
did you guys all see Sing Street, Tim and Jordan?
Yep.
Yes. Love
Sing Street.
It cracked my top 10.
Dude, yeah, I liked it a lot. Yeah,
I loved it.
Top five for me.
Favorite song, real quick. Favorite song from Sing Street.
Oh, the one that's
the slow one.
Oh, really?
Dude.
Yeah.
Which one? Really
so good. The slow one.
The slow song.
I was gonna say the one at the end, dude. The last song they play on stage, dude. Oh,
yeah,
that was like,
I'm actually between that one and the one where they like their first song when they're filming the music video.
Oh yeah, yeah. Remember in the motto.
The riddle of the motto. And they're all dressed up in like the goofy ass costumes.
It looked like an 80s. It was so cool though. It looked
I
was watching like an 80s video.
Yeah, man. Awesome. Yeah, it was great. It was a good movie.
My favorite song was actually In Between Days by The Cure. My favorite one.
Nice. Yeah, but that was
the ending. Fucking makes me like sob.
Yeah, dude, that's a sad movie. I was so into the end, man. Like it was just such good. Awesome
the ending
movie.
Made me go like, "Fuck yeah!" Like I was with my brother. I was just like, "Yeah!" I loved it.
Yeah,
dude,
that was very good.
I don't want to get into spoilers because I know a lot of people haven't like.
Right, yeah, spoiler alert. But it's on Netflix, so everybody should go watch it.
You should. Yeah, everybody should go watch Sing Street. It's such a – I said like in a year of like blockbusters of people taking over the world, you have Sing Street. It's just about a kid who really likes a girl who makes up a lie that he has to go through with because he really wants to date this girl, and he ends up forming his band that he loves. I love it. I love Sing Street.
I think the only – like I loved it too. I think I gave it either 5 out of 5 or 4.5 out of 5. But the only gripe, I guess, and it could just be because I was watching it, you know, on my TV, I had to turn the subtitles on because some of their accents were thick. Like
the redhead.
The redhead, yeah. He was there. Kid. You know, I watched it with my girlfriend, and like within the first 5 minutes, she's like, "Can we like turn on subtitles?" Like, I can't understand anything. I'm like, "Yeah, no problem."
Yeah, no, that's the very. I actually, going off that, I wanted to say I watched the David Brent Life on the Road, the movie about the BBC office.
Oh, I saw that was uploaded. It's like years later, following that character, right?
Yeah, I was a big fan of the BBC Office show, so when I saw that was on Netflix, I was like, oh, I'm watching this, dude. And I would give it like a 3.5 out of 5. Like, it was funny, dude. If you're into that, like, you will find a lot of enjoyment from Ricky Gervais. He's so just like in that role. And,
nice.
I've never even heard of this.
So it's like
not even like the original character.
So it's funny. Like, you know, on The Office, the American version of The Office, it's like Michael Scott. It's like the UK's Office, Michael Scott, but his name's, what was it, Matt? David Brent.
David Brent, yeah.
Oh, shoot. This is a continuation of his character?
Yeah, like years later, the documentary crew follows him around, like what the boss is up to, you know?
That's so smart.
Dude, and he's working, like, just to give you the lowdown, he's working as a salesman at this, like, company where they're on phones trying to sell stuff, and he saves up his money and vacation time, and then he goes on a tour with this band. And, like, dude, he pays the band to play with him, and then his tour is literally, like, in his neighborhood, like, in, like, 5 or 7 bars. They at hotels every night, even though they live 4 miles away from all the bars.
Oh my God.
Like, dude, it is so funny how in the hole he gets with money. He's, like, just, like, it's like $20,000 in the hole. Like,
dude, that's awesome. Funny. I can't wait to watch that.
That looks great.
But real quick, I just wanted to say I finally saw Manchester by the Sea as well.
Yeah.
How did you like it?
I loved it. It was one of my favorites of the year for sure.
Yes, yeah. I love that movie.
Cuts deep, so that movie.
Yes, it does. Yeah. It stays with me, man. Oh, man. Yeah.
How do you feel about the younger boy being nominated for best supporting?
Good for him. Like, when I saw it, I was genuinely shocked. Like, I didn't think that he was good in the movie, but I didn't think he would get nominated. Mm-hmm. But there isn't many, like, I haven't seen Nocturnal Animals. There's still some movies I haven't seen, but there isn't that many best supporting, like, performances that I would take out for him. So I would say good for him. He's like 16 and he got nominated. So
I thought the panic attack scene is probably what got him.
Yeah.
Oh,
the refrigerator.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like Lucas Hedges, like that's the scene they're gonna play. Like the freezer scene. That's absolutely what they're gonna play for that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And like he had really good, you know, it like what's the word? Can't even talk, dude. He had really good charisma and personality and like a connection with Casey Affleck. Like it felt like a believable uncle nephew relationship.
Right.
So
yeah.
What's it on your list, Matt?
Oh, I don't have a like specific list yet, but you know, if I'm spitballing, I'm gonna say like number 5. Like number 4 or 5. Like it's up there. Honestly, like, I'm thinking if I was just to go over things real quick, like, Arrival, I think, would be my number one. Batman Superman is, like, in 1 through 3 somewhere in there, maybe 2 or 3.
Number 3?
Yeah, that's probably where it'd be. Manchester by the Sea, Sing Street, you know, those are all up there for me, so it's kind of hard. If I really went over it, I could come up with something.
Dude.
But.
Matt, that's hilarious because when you're talking, it's like the same as my. Well, Arrival's my number one. Batman v Superman's my number 2. The director's cut, obviously. La La Land. Well, dude, I mean, I don't know. Maybe people haven't seen it, you know? La La Land's number 3. Hell or High Water's number 4. And then I had Lion at number 5 and Sing Street at number 6. But I might flip those or I might just move Manchester to 5.
Yeah. Yeah, that's cool.
They're all, but I rated them all like 5 or 4.5.
Jordan, what's your top 5? Top, yeah.
I got I have Hacksaw Ridge at number 1, La La Land at 2, Hella High Water at 3, Patriots Day at 4, and your guys got Civil War at 5.
Mm. Nice,
nice
to see,
nice.
That's
dude.
A diverse like top 5. I like.
Yeah, it is.
Like, mine's just Rogue One, Arrival, BVS, Edge of 17, and Sing Street.
That's
I was going to say, call me crazy, but I like those. Those are good. And I, because I liked most of the, you know, I heard so many people this year say, oh my God, 2016, another letdown of a year.
Yeah, we had a great year.
I saw a bunch of good movies this year. Like, yeah. I thought I liked most of what I saw.
Like, you even saw to round off the top 10, I mean, this could easily have been in the top five and in the other year. Like, yeah, Moonlight, it's up, and Moonlight's a near flawless movie. Deadpool, which I had, that's the most fun I had in the theater this year. The Nice Guys, Manchester by the Sea, Sing Street, Arrival. You got a lot of good movies that came out this year, man. Like, I don't.
No, I agree. Yeah. Like, yeah. I would take, like, my top 15 or top 20 over what year was really disappointing. I think 2014 wasn't that good. But, yeah, we had a lot of.
Best.
Or was it 15?
15, probably.
It's 15, but dude,
1956 was great.
1908, you know.
Yeah, Metropolis, and I can't think of anything else.
Yeah, they didn't have color, like but it was a really good year. I don't get people that are hating on it.
So much better than last year. So much better.
So, yeah, no, it was very memorable for me. But I wanted to say real quick. We don't have too much time left. I know we all got stuff to do or nothing to do, you know, whatever. but I wanted to say, let's do a quick little rapid fire round about these 2017 films we've seen. Because I'm sure if you're like me, you've seen anywhere from 1 to 5 releases this year so far. And so we'll go down the line, just talk a little bit about each one. And then when we're done with that, we can do like an open discussion to end it. If that's all right.
Cool.
So
Silence, I will never, like, it was good, but I'll never watch again. Split gets better and better the more I think about it. I love Split. That movie made me, like, say, holy shit at the end of it. It gave me a theater experience that I'll never forget. Love Split. And the Lego Batman movie, which was a lot of fun. It's not nearly as good as the Lego movie, though. I've thought about that. It's not even, like, it doesn't have the emotional pull that the Lego movie did. But I still think it was a lot of fun. And John, you haven't seen it yet?
Not yet. So please, no spoilers. I'm seeing it in a couple days.
There's some don't get me wrong. There's some great jokes in there, man. There's some great stuff,
dude. Yeah. I hear it's like a love letter to like Batman's whole 75 years. Yeah, I can't wait.
Pretty much every line of dialogue is an Easter egg. You can make a case for like every single thing was something.
Yeah. Like a reference,
yeah.
Cool. Yeah, I can't wait. I'm so excited.
Yeah, it's really fun.
So,
that's it.
So, is that what you saw so far? Are you seen anything else, or those were the titles so far?
Oh no, those are the only things I've seen. I'm seeing Get Out Saturday, but so far that's all.
Nice. How about you, Tim?
I've seen 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 films. So, and I've actually been ranking them as I've been going. So, in this order. For starting from number one to the worst, XXX is my number one film, dude. Whoa! That movie was so much fun. I haven't had that much fun in a theater, you know, for a long time. number two was John Wick 2. Awesome. Except when I saw it in theaters, some guy brought his baby in and it was crying and talking during it, so I need to see it again. It really ruined the experience.
John Wick needed to kill that baby, you know what I'm talking about? I don't get why people bring infants to movies, dude.
No, especially like
I get it. You want to see John Wick, dude. I don't blame you. Dude, just go on, get your like Fire Stick Cody thing and just fucking get it offline.
That sucks so much.
Number three, Split. I'm going to mirror exactly what Jordan said. That ending, my jaw was dropped to the floor.
Yeah.
I didn't know it either. And I've been doing this new thing where I've been including in Netflix specials into my rankings because if they're from 2017, fuck it.
Right.
Make my list.
They are.
Yeah,
it beefs up the list. BUTL, beef up that list. I added Neil Brennan, Three Mics. This was the guy who co-wrote Chappelle's Show with Dave Chappelle.
Oh, cool.
Oh, cool.
Dude, just check it out. He has three mics, one for one-liners, two for regular stand-up bits, and three for heavy emotional stuff. And he fades out and goes to the next mic, and it's really diverse show. Number five, Resident Evil. Not as good as I expected it to be, but I'm a loyal Jovovich fan. next one, Lego Batman. Dude, I'm going to mirror exactly what Jordan said. Really did not do it for me. Really big letdown. I enjoyed it, but like you said, it's missing the emotional tug, the emotional thing that the Lego movie had. And the last one is Roger Corman's Death Race 2050.
Oh. They made another Death Race? I don't even...
Dude, Roger Corman.
Damn.
It was embarrassing. Matt, I really hope you can check it out soon. Like, I mean, I hope all you guys can, but like, Matt, I feel like you watch a lot of these shitty movies, and I feel like even you can't like muster up the courage to enjoy this movie.
Damn.
So no. Here's the thing: just on the DL, I might get to work on Roger Corman Productions at some point soon.
Oh shit!
I work for are friends with him.
That's awesome. Damn. Well, I mean, look,
I was like, I'll do it.
It would be fun to work on this. Like, that's the beauty of these shitty movies. They're fun and to think about working on them because everyone likes schlock and making schlocks could be fun. But this movie looked like they went to Getty and looked up like After Effects overlays and they just bought a shitload of stuff and put it all together.
Oh, I buy that. 100%.
That's my list.
Oh,
nice. Yeah, I like that. Good list. How about you? What did you watch this year?
I'll say what Tim said for my list. I've only seen three 2017 releases. Like everything else I've seen this year was from last year. But John Wick Chapter 2 is my top title of the year so far. Yeah, just what you guys were saying. It was awesome. I think it was very, very – I think it's a great movie. I just don't think that it had as strong as a narrative as the first one because he has that drive of, you know, obviously the revenge. With this, it's more like he's trying to get out at any means possible. And it's still a really entertaining, enjoyable ride. Like, I give it, I don't know, like an A- or a B+. I loved it. I just was missing some of that, like, motivation behind it. But you do see him kind of develop as a character, too. Like, I don't know, like, there's subtle little nods are a little like, okay, he doesn't want to do this. Like when he's suiting up and he just shouts in anger, you know, it's like they kind of are slowly developing Wick. So I hope that third one happens and I hope they like round out a really cool trilogy. But and then I saw Split and I'm gonna like, I don't know, guys, I liked it, but I also never saw Unbreakable. So that ending fell on deaf ears. It's been on my watch list forever. And I'm like, I got to go watch the good M. Night movies. And I'm like, but then I'm like, oh, he made Split, like M. Night's back, baby. And I didn't see all those articles about like all the spoiler or the twist. So I saw it and I thought it was a really solid thriller and scary. Like it had really creepy elements and it was a good movie. But that ending, I'm like, there's Bruce Willis. All right. I just did not get the ending because I haven't seen Unbreakable. And, other people in my theater were like, oh, shit, like, hype. And then other people were like, huh? Like, me. Like, I was just like, but I went by myself. So I'm sitting there, like, in the third row, and I'm like, all right. But I got to make it a point to watch Unbreakable. But I did like it still. I thought it was a cool movie. It's just
As a fan of comic books, you have to watch Unbreakable.
Yeah, that's what I hear. Yeah, I hear it's great.
It's my favorite M. Night movie.
So I gotta watch Unbreakable and then rewatch Split. But I still thought it was a really cool movie, even on its own merits. Like even not getting this twist. But and then my last movie, last but not least, is Resident Evil: The Final Chapter. I got off of work one night and I'm like, you know what, dude? It's coming out tonight, Thursday night. I'm like, I'll go see it. I went by myself. Two other people in the theater with me. And it's something.
You texted me and are like, you're gonna hate it. And I felt like when I was walking to the theater, I was like, no, fuck you, John. I'm like, I'm gonna make myself like this.
I just wanted to like kind of temper your expectations is all, I guess. Just kind of give you a heads up that it was something.
You can't break me.
Look, I'll say this. Like, yeah, like, if you go in just, like, expecting, like, you know, whatever, it's an enjoyable, like, gory, you know, not even trilogy ender, double trilogy ender, whatever number it is. And it, like, you know, it obviously, like, casted away the video game stuff long ago, so, like, it's made its own franchise. But, man, those jump cuts, dude.
Yeah,
gave me a headache. And, I mean, I sat, like, kind of, not close, but not far, and I was just like, oh, my God, like, 20 shots within one, like, action sequence of just, like, punch, one punch. They cut it up into, like, five cuts. I'm like, it's kind of mind-boggling when you think about that. Like, they set up all these shots with the camera and audio and everybody for, like, just a snippet of footage. And it's just, yeah.
I think it's edited by the guy who did Ghost Rider 2.
It doesn't surprise me. I mean, yeah, like, it had some cool moments and stuff. But, like, you know, they tried to make a huge budgeted movie with, like, a really small budget. And it kind of showed a lot. But there were cool parts in it. I'm not going to, like, hate completely on it. And there's some merit to it. It just wasn't my, like, you know.
Cup of tea.
Cup of tea, yeah. To each their own. I ain't going to hate people if they liked it.
No, for sure. So that's what that was your the ones you've seen
just,
so far?
Yeah, I just saw three. But and then, like, yeah. I said, tomorrow I'll see Get Out. Saturday, so I'm seeing Lego Batman. Next week I'm going to try to catch A Cure for Wellness if I have the time. And then I'm gonna see Logan next weekend.
Oh, I can't. I don't. Oh man, Logan.
I'm excited.
I need it.
Yeah.
I gotta make time to see that though, because the new Zelda game comes out the same day. So I'm gonna, like, in a marathon Zelda, take a 2-hour break, go see Logan, and then go back to playing Zelda.
Nice. I'm in the similar boat. I've seen three movies from 2017. Real quick, I forgot. I also saw a 2016 movie this morning called USS Indianapolis Men of Courage. It's a World War II film starring Nicolas Cage, Tom Sizemore, and Thomas Jane. Okay, before you jump to the gun here, not a bad movie, dude. Honestly, like, wholeheartedly. Worth a watch. You might not want to rewatch it because it's like a 2-hour movie, but, like, really good story, really, like, shot very well. It had a $40 million budget. I think it was from, like, Lionsgate. There's some CGI effects that aren't that great. It was like, dude, the performances are there. It's a true story, and it's not like a I can predict this true story. Like, the ending, it's not this, like, oh, it's a happy, happy ending. Like, they take some turns on you, and you're like, shit, this is pretty good. I'd give it, like, a 3.5 out of 5. Like, it was honestly a pretty solid movie. But
cool.
Yeah, like, but then, yeah, Tom Jane's awesome, dude. But yeah. 2017 movies, I saw John Wick 2. That's my number one spot right now. I thought it was almost as good as the first one. I thought it was great. I thought it was so much fun to watch. The action was so entertaining.
Really quick.
Yeah.
Sorry. So, no, I meant to bring it up earlier with John Wick, and now that you're talking about it. So, did you guys, when you were watching it, did you guys count the body count?
No.
Okay, well, I did. I did. Do you guys want to guess how many people he killed?
87.
87? 200, Matt? Oh, wait, I might have told you, actually.
100.
Okay, you're all wrong. He approximately killed 152 people.
And then, in one movie.
Right. I did count. Like, sometimes they cut away, and, like, when it showed, like, a villain walking through the hallway and you hear other people dying, I counted. I tried to estimate those counts by 3 gunshots because it seemed like he shot people, like, a few times when he killed someone. Like, usually he would shoot people twice in the head and twice in the chest, once in the head. So I, like, you know, if I heard, like, 6 shots, I'm like, okay, that was probably 2 people. So it's a give or take. It's give or take 152.
Damn.
Is that crazy, dude? I mean, I thought it was
cool.
I mean, but yeah, that was a great movie.
That's like the I haven't seen the second one, but that sounds like the nightclub scene in the first one, like, done 5 times.
Yep. Yeah. Well, it kind of is. You gotta see it.
Oh, damn.
You gotta see it.
I'm gonna see it soon. I'm gonna make time for it.
Cool.
Yeah. And so then that's my number one right now. My number two right now is the Lego Batman movie. I thought it was super enjoyable. It was not as good as the Lego movie, but it was super fun. I thought Will Arnett is just hilarious. So Batman, Michael Cera, like, they were all just killer. Like, I had such a fun time when I saw it. And And then the third movie I saw, which being third on the list doesn't mean I dislike it at all, is Split. I like Split a lot. I thought it was really good. I think I'd prefer watching Lego Batman and John Wick over it again, but those three movies I could see myself owning, honestly. Nice. If we could, real quick, before we end this, I kind of think since we all did see Split, it would be cool to kind of have a quick little chat about it without maybe not spoiling it, but just to kind of surface any of that.
So no spoilers for Split?
I guess we could, actually. It's been long enough.
I mean, John already kind of spoiled it.
Really. Oh, yeah. Yeah, there we go. Yeah.
Shoot. Yeah, guys, spoiler.
Okay. We'll put that in the title.
Yes. That sounds good. Split spoiler talk.
Tim, when did you realize that it was – because it's different from everybody I talked to. When did you realize, oh, shit, this is Unbreakable? Like, when did you realize that?
I started to wonder when – he left the house and went to the subway. Subway. And then because there's a scene, because I know that Bruce Willis, he went to, in Unbreakable, he went to that subway station.
It's the same one.
Yeah, it is the same one. That's what I thought. And I was like, that can't be, but that's cool. And then I was blown away, like, at the end.
I was wondering, like, I didn't know, like, I'm not going to pretend like I know this, like, scores right offhand, but it was a familiar score. He was talking to himself in the mirror, and, like, I heard this music.
With the music.
I didn't know where it came from.
Was it, like, the exact same score? Did you look it up after? Or was
it's a track. It's the same track.
Oh, shit. Cool.
I never knew that.
That's cool. That's actually, like, building up, like, it's, like, building up people's, like, that sounds like, and then it's building towards that twist right before that scene or right after that scene. Mm-hmm. Nice. That's
whenever cool. It was going across the bar and she said, what was that other guy's name?
Yeah.
Mr. Glass. And I was, oh, fuck. And then you saw Bruce Willis and it's David Dunn. He's amazing, man. He's in his uniform. And I was like, oh, shit. I was like the only one screaming. I was like, oh, my God. And everybody's like, God, it's fucking weird.
He's a weirdo over there.
I know. I literally explained the ending to the entire theater. I'm not kidding.
Like, oh, really?
Nobody knew anything. Well, to explain it.
It's funny because, like, horror movies draw, like, a lot of young viewers, like teens and stuff. So they see this preview and they think it just looks like a really cool horror movie with the guy that played Charles Xavier in the X-Men movies. And they probably didn't see Unbreakable. Like, how long has it been since Unbreakable? When did that
come? 2000. So
like, it's been
like 15 years. Yeah.
It's been a long, it's been a minute, So I feel like, that's probably why you had to explain it. I wish I was in the theater. You could have explained it to me.
Matt, did anyone, Matt, did you get it spoiled for you? And Jordan, did you know of it ahead of time or you didn't?
No clue. No.
I did not know about it ahead of time. I've seen Unbreakable, so I knew what was going on when Bruce Willis popped up. I was like, oh, shit. Connected. I will say, like, I liked Split a lot. Like, I gave it a 3.5 out of 5, and I would definitely watch it again because I thought James McAvoy and Anya Taylor, whatever her name is, I thought they were excellent. Like, they were so good.
They stole the show.
Yeah, and M. Night wrote a really good movie, like, and he directed a really good, there's some great camera work in Split, and there's some awesome just attention and just like weirdness to it. I will say though, I thought the twist was cool, but and this is, you might not agree with me and that's cool, but I thought it was a little cheap. Like, it's a little easy to just be like, oh, it's connected to this other movie I made 15, 17, years ago. Like, I get it, what he was going for, and obviously it works because it's like that, it's just taking place in the same world, and there's apparently going to be a sequel that's about both of them and that's going to happen.
He's still out there.
Because I agree with you. I mean, and this is coming obviously from someone who hasn't seen Unbreakable, but if it's like a twist within that story, it's kind of like not really within that story, I guess. Like, as a piece of cinema, like, you could talk about the twist with other M. Night movies like The Sixth Sense, you know, that was a twist, you know, within this story. With this story, like, if you just watch it as its own story, the only twist is that it's not really a twist. It's just like it's almost like a spinoff or a spiritual successor, you know?
I actually thought that there's two twists in this movie. The first twist is finding out that the reason he's able to, you know, take on these people is that I never made the connection that he was underneath the zoo, and all the times he referenced animals, he was taking inspiration. That was kind of cool. I will say my one gripe, I'm going off of Matt's gripes, is that if you're going to tell me that he's going to become a beast, don't just make him some ripped superhuman. I wanted to see red eyes, like the drawings on the walls and shit.
I was wondering throughout the whole film, I'm like, okay, is he going to do this, like have a transformation? Like, I was like, what is this beast he's talking about? And you're right. In that aspect, it's a little bit like, damn, he just kind of got ripped. His veins, his veins got bulgy. He got really sweaty. And like, that was it. But it was, don't get me wrong, it was creepy. Like, he choked out the therapist and snapped her neck with ease. Like, if you were like that railroad worker, he didn't actually get a look at him, but if you were just like walking at night on duty and you just see like a dash of like a bald dude like swinging by, like, it's that'd be really scary. But you're right. Like, I think like the whole beast thing, I was kind of like, I didn't know though, because then like how would you react if he did like transform into like a werewolf or like a beast? Like
give me red eyes, that's all I want.
I was just wondering that was my dilemma, is like I was slightly disappointed and slightly satisfied with the whole thing at the end when he's like climbing on walls and punching the lights out.
That was so cool.
It was creepy. Yeah. And I was like, you know, it was effective, but at the same time, I was like, man, like the beast though, I was thinking of like, you know, cause you see those drawings, it kind of lets your mind run wild. So it was kind of a dilemma. I was like, I'm kind of torn about that. I was like, man, it'd be cool if he like really transformed. But like at the same time, it might've been really cheesy.
Right. But the thing too is I'm not trying to say it's a cheap ending, because I thought the zoo twist was awesome. Yeah. Dang, that's clever. I'm like, that's cool. Like with the walkie talkie and stuff. Like I thought, or like the phone, remember that whole part? Like I thought that was cool. I was like, oh, I didn't think of that. Like that totally makes sense. And then like on the way out with the guy, and I just thought that was a cool thing. But and if anything, I don't mean to consider it cheap. It's more of I should just watch Unbreakable again because it's been too long. And when I'm looking now at this cover and seeing it say Split and there's like the crack glass, it's cool when you look at that. And then you think of the title Unbreakable. Like I think that's a cool like correlation. Yeah. And that makes more sense now when I think about that, you know, and that makes me want to watch both again. So I liked it a lot.
Well, M. Night had came out and said that even like before the movie Split even came out, that this character, Kevin something, I can't remember his last, James McAvoy's character in Split, apparently is a character that he actually wanted to include in Unbreakable, but he couldn't find the reason. Like he created this character when he created Unbreakable. And he has like a 3-part setup, and he tweeted, I'm trying to find his exact tweet, because not too long ago he tweeted something about it.
He said he has a 10-page outline for something.
For his next film. And then he put, if you've seen Split, ... And like, I was like, oh, give me that movie now. I need it.
Yeah.
The only thing that I feel is, like, I can see what you're talking about this ending. It's like, as cool as it was, did it need to be made? Because if you watch Unbreakable, and I'm not going to spoil it for you, John, but like,
okay,
there's a reason why the two characters in Unbreakable are the main center of attention. And there's a reason, there's motives behind Samuel Jackson. There's motives behind Bruce Willis, and the character development is it's like anti-hero versus hero. Like it makes sense.
Cool.
And to just build this extended universe where now all of a sudden it's almost like Bruce Willis is now fighting everyone. It's valid and it still works. But at the end of the day, like it's not the reasoning. Like it's not as poetic as Unbreakable is.
Right. It feels kind of just like a serialized comic book. Like, oh, here's a new villain emerging from the shadows. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I guess like we'll have to wait to see this, you know, the sequel too, because then if this third movie really starts to connect with Unbreakable, or like they give the main character a reason, then maybe we'll feel differently about it. Yeah. Like if it's one big story. But I was gonna say, we talked about the twist and we talked about like the whole beast thing, but like we haven't actually talked about like the movie. Like what did you guys think about how did you feel about like the pacing, the secondary characters? How did you feel about, you know, just like how they handled all of his identities? Like, did you guys think, were you guys genuinely, like, were you scared or not really? You were just more.
I was entertained throughout. Like, the movie never dragged. The beginning kind of dragged because I thought the dialogue at the beginning was wonky. And I don't even know if it was a dialogue as much less as the secondary characters were a big flaw for me because, God, they were bad. Especially the blonde. She, in, like, so many scenes, she was just like, we got to take him out. We gotta take him out, and like she's like, what are you doing, dude?
They kind of like fell into the horror cliche tropes.
Yeah, doing that on purpose, but
right, yeah. It didn't feel like it was doing it on purpose, because then you would get almost like I feel like they would have played it up more. Like it seemed like he was directing a very serious scene that came off as schlocky.
Yeah,
yeah,
but I love the way he handled the personalities, especially especially Hedrick.
The dance
I love it. And his lines. Now, like, when I'm talking about to people, I'm like, et cetera. Like, I just, like, sometimes I add that at the end of it. Et cetera.
That's awesome, dude. That was a really good line. I mean, yeah, the way they, like, did the identities, I thought was very cool. And, like, how they... It's like they're trying to claw at the opening. They're one shot at the light to like gain control of the body. That was cool. Mm-hmm. So you have like these 23 identities all trying to like break through and take control.
That was very interesting. Oh, go on, Tim. Sorry.
Really quickly. This is a weird thing to say. I really enjoyed the character development of the main girl. By using the flashbacks, they're really disturbing, but it was a good reveal.
I was going to bring that up. Yeah, I was about to bring that
uncomfortable,
up.
Uncomfortable. Like, whenever you realize what it is, it was very – I felt very uncomfortable in a – like, not a good way, but the way he wanted us to feel uncomfortable, I felt.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, honestly, like, that uncle can go up. Weirdo.
Yeah. That was really effective. I kind of wish they gave like a little more time to the main character. Like if it was like other flashbacks or just like more time before they got kidnapped, you know, like a little bit more. I would have welcomed that too, because I like the main character. I just wish I knew a little like bit more. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Why was she invited with her?
Didn't her parents like make her? I'm trying to remember. The dad was like,
her dad said that she was like a loner in school or something.
Tim, you bring up a good point, because it's like, how big is the school? Because then, like, wouldn't she have to invite like everybody in the class? Because it was only like a handful of girls there, and whatever.
Right.
Now we're just nitpicking.
Like we've been talking about, I love Split. Definitely has its flaws. What we talked about, including the worst therapist ever. The old lady was the worst therapist ever. And I love Split. I love Unbreakable. Really, to the end one.
Nice.
My camera's not working. Do you guys see that?
I noticed that too. I heard people knocking on shit.
No, I think somebody knocked him out.
I thought Split was a very good movie. I do think it's a one-time watch. I don't think I'll need to see it again. I think, John, when you see Unbreakable, you'll see why that movie has such a cult following. And Split, to be honest, looking forward to what M. Night does next, I have to admit, I don't want to see Hedwig's character again. What I hope happens is they do a sequel with Bruce Willis, but Hedwig is out in the wilderness, whatever, and he's gone, and he never, maybe it's a cameo, but I don't want to see another Split with James McAvoy. Yeah. I want to see another bat, like another villain.
Sure, yeah. No, that makes total sense. And Yeah, I agree. Like, I agree with Matt. I gave it, like, I think I gave it a 3.5, which is kind of like a 7 out of 10. You know, like a solid movie, not bad, not great, but I probably would bump it up if I saw Unbreakable. But, yeah, I mean, I'm with you. Like, in terms of what M. Night wants to do next, you know, I'm actually – I think he needs to do a sequel to The Last Airbender. And I'm just kidding. No, like
the last Airbender.
The last, or they could call it, the second to last Airbender.
But, last Airbender, The Reckoning.
Yeah, but no, like I mean, I'm down for him to do a sequel. But like you said, it'd be cool if they like created a whole new thing, and it would be nice to see him do other like new original stuff too. Because now that he's back, hopefully, like in good standing, hopefully he can get some good movies going. I mean, who doesn't love Lady in the Water and The Happening?
I like The Village.
Yeah, that was that one? I was I
The Village was good.
Yeah, no,
it's a good twist, and it's
yeah.
Actually,
yeah, it had a really
clever.
I want to see it again though, because I saw it at a young age, and I think I don't know if my opinion would change on it, but I definitely do want to watch it again. Because it's been like over 10 years since I've seen it, I feel like.
Me too.
But yeah, so I mean, I don't know where Jordan went, but I don't know if you guys are ready to wrap up or if we should wait for him to.
Oh, okay. I think he's here.
Jordan.
Banging on my window, and he was like, "Are you done?"
Oh no, dude, you're good. We were wrapping up though, because I didn't want to keep you guys, and I gotta start to go get out, because I gotta go get out.
For sure. Wink, wink.
Yeah. No, I'm excited though. I'm hoping it's really good.
I hear it's good.
I hear it's really good.
I mean, does it still have 100?
It does today.
That unprecedented 100% on Rotten Tomatoes. Oh boy! No, I'm just kidding. I mean, that is cool that you know you could boast about that.
It is still 100%.
Oh,
damn! That's impressive.
Dude, all it's gonna take is one asshole on Friday when that movie comes out to be like, "Nope, I don't like this."
Like Mad Max.
Yeah.
Out of 96 people, damn.
That's no, that's super good. But I just want to say real quick, thank you to you guys for coming on here and talking to me, and thanks to those who want to watch this.
No, thanks, John, Matt. It was fun talking to you guys. Thanks for having me. And Tim, it was nice to talk to you as well. I'm not going to leave
as
you
out. Always, as always. Yeah.
Always.
I got to mirror exactly what Jordan said. And I also got to say, I think I might see Collide this weekend as well. It looks fucking sweet.
I saw a commercial for that. I'm like, this is the first I'm hearing about this movie ever.
Dude, yeah. It looks awesome. It looks like Need for Speed. Anyway, that's thank you so much, guys. It's really, really fun, as always.
Thanks,
and
Tim.
Jordan. Yeah. And Jordan, too.
Thanks.
It's really fun talking to you,
too. I'm drinking my sorrows away.
Yeah, dude. Well, yeah, thanks. Thank you, guys. That was a bunch of fun. We'll do this again real soon. All you little people out there watching, don't forget to hit that, smash that like button and subscribe for more content, you know.
Smash that MF like button, my friends.
Yeah, we actually, yeah, smash that mo. Yeah, we got like more stuff in the pipeline. Matt, when's Trash Can Kids coming? It's soon, right?
We're working on it. Yep, we're working on it. We got the first two episodes done. We're going to try to do like 6 to 8 episodes for season one. That's still being developed and recorded. And then I got the Faber Hotel video that we did with Tim that I still got to finish up. It's close. Yeah. Close.
It'll hit that 1 year anniversary mark.
Yeah, don't think I forgot. Yeah.
But yeah,
it'll be good.
Right, we got like so much crap in the pipeline. So thanks for everyone's patience. You know, we're at Matt's working his tail off. I'm at school and working, and stuff's coming. So thanks for everybody just, you know, holding out. There'll be a video this week actually being uploaded. The Nintendo Switch event. I got to go to Chicago. I got invited by Nintendo to try out the new video game system, and I know it's nothing to do with film, but we made it into like original comedy skit / documentary, so you guys will I think enjoy it. Nice. That should be out by Monday night, if not Tuesday. Wednesday by the latest. And then the Switch comes out Friday, so everyone can watch that and decide if they want it. Hopefully you guys laugh. We had a lot of fun, a lot of goofs and gaffs.
Nice.
Gaffs. thank you to our loyal 626 subscribers that I notice is constantly declining, and I notice our viewership is around 100. So thank you. Truly. Dude, thank you.
If you're watching this and you're new, subscribe. Let's get to that 666 number, the magic number. And
Iron Maiden tickets.
Yep.
The number of.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, thank you guys, and we'll see you soon.
Yeah,
bye. Deuces.